r/nuclear revenge. First story. Supervisor takes credit for my work. I cause entire production to shut down. I started working in a machine shop after I finished school with a 2-year degree in machining. Learned all kinds of programming techniques that could make most machines that were less than 30 years old perform moves and output measurements of parts currently in the machine to automatically perform quality control. This greatly increases quality of parts as well as reduce waste and human error. I also learned many tricks along the way to make sure that my work could not be stolen. It's my first day on the machine shop floor, and I immediately notice inefficiencies in all the machines in my station. We had to manually perform quality control, sacrificing production time, while also leaving tons of room for human error due to the poor quality of measuring instruments in the shop. I'm new and eager to prove I'm worth more than the original pay they offered. I told my supervisor to let me spend an hour to add a line of code to a machine to demonstrate my skills I learned in school that would immediately cut scrap/waste down by a large portion without slowing production rates on the line. My immediate supervisor humored me, thinking I was bsing him to try and brown-nose the engineers and lead programmers so I could get brownie points or something. Quick backstory to note point: I had zero experience in a production plant, and said supervisor had 30 years experience in the field. He had a very proud attitude and genuinely worked very hard to learn what he knew. He was decent to work with, but when I asked questions about some of the basics on this machine, like how to get to the program so I could edit it, he would block my view of what he was doing and get to the end result quickly without explaining the process. Being new and wanting to learn, I'd always ask to have him show me what he did. He always refused and claimed it was his way of securing his job. Anyway, I program the function into the machine in about 2 hours, 40 minutes, and when it comes time to demonstrate the process, it catches a part that is out of tolerances according to the blueprint. I also programmed the machine to output different messages, providing instructions to whoever the operator was on ways to resolve the issue if the part couldn't be salvaged, or to automatically adjust offsets of the tool that machined the feature that was found to be out of tolerances, and rerun said operation and recheck said feature to ensure quality. All of these functions were performed automatically without any input from an operator. This is a pretty magnificent feature to have in production, and my supervisor knew that. The supervisor who observed the demo immediately went to report this to higher-ups, who came to view the new feature I had implemented. As the next part was being produced, the quality check move initiated and found that the second part was also bad and output a message to change tools X, Y, and Z. The managers were incredibly surprised that this was all done on our 18-year-old machine, and they looked to my supervisor to ask how he figured it out. Long story short, he took the credit and was given a raise on the spot. It didn't register to me that that's what happened until I went to ask if he was going to credit me for my work. He said, "Yeah, but you gotta put in the time to get to where I'm at. It don't matter that you did the job, 'cause without me, you never would've known how to do your fancy programming in the first place." The managers had left for the day, so I couldn't fight my case right then. The next day, I was planning on informing the managers that I was the one who did the programming to do that. The managers were also former machine shop veterans with 20 plus years in the workplace and refused to believe me. Not only that, they basically yelled at me for trying to steal credit from someone who has worked their way up in the company and learned everything on their own and not from some school. I went to my station even more pissed now, where I was met by my supervisor. He told me that I needed to go around to all the machines that could perform that function and add it to the code. I said, "Not without a raise. My code saves you guys tons and brings the bottom line to a level that McDonald's qualified workers could produce infinite numbers of parts with minimal loss." He said if I didn't do it, I would be fired. So I faked my compliance and started to change code on all the machines. If you know anything about programming, you know you can make something function a certain way until a certain value is met, and then have it completely change afterwards. This was my job security. So I set the quality check up on 18 machines the first day, then the last 30 that weekend, and the managers were praising the supervisor uncontrollably for his innovation. Well, The programs were all set to operate as normal and do quality checks, like I programmed the original machine. However, I programmed the rest of the machines to keep track of a new variable. They would run and self-check just fine until they reached a random number of parts produced, 50 to 500 depending on the production time of the parts run on each machine, where it would then throw up an error code that would only be cleared with a password I had set for it. If a wrong password was provided or someone just hit the enter/reset button, the machine would take its largest tool in the turret and run it rapidly into the solid chuck at maximum RPMs. I made it so about 65 to 75 hours of production would go smoothly before my job security would kick in. It took 3 days for the machines to hit their magic values, but when they did, boy oh boy, was it magically satisfying. The first machine to crash was making parts for the driver lines of a major motor company. The crash was caused while a new operator was running the machine, who I might add, was only hired because the program I made let them hire clueless people into the shop and be able to still produce good parts. When he tried to clear my password code, the lathe started turning at 2500 RPMs with a large heavy drive shaft base in the holder, switched to a huge drill, and ran the drill into the holder, causing the tool holder to be knocked off axis, the part holder and tools to be destroyed, as well as cost the company tons to get someone from the machine's maintenance team out to repair it. After the first glorious crash, I menacingly mentioned to the supervisor, "You should check your codes to make sure they're working properly." He went ghost white. Not a second after, 3 more machines simultaneously crash in glorious fashion. He starts to chew me out, saying I'm in huge trouble, but as he starts cursing, the managers are there to have him go diagnose the problems with his codes. The supervisor, not wanting to admit he stole my work, doubles down and says confidently, "I know what the problem is," and walks off to the crashed machines. Not a minute after they turn a corner, more machines start crashing. I just sit idly by and listen to the glorious sounds of my nuclear revenge playing out. A few minutes later, all the workers are told to stop production completely. We are all kept in the shop until they can figure out the problems. This is a 24-hour production facility with 3 shifts of workers coming in 7 days a week, mind you. Our shift is nearly over, and we've all been idle for about 7 hours. The next shift comes in, and we leave for the day. I hear nothing from the shop, so I just go in the next day as normal. Turns out they tried to fire machines back up during the night shift and 18 more machines crashed like the others. The plant did a formal layoff of most of the workers the next week, as they were hemorrhaging money from all the damaged machines on top of labor paid without any production. We filed a class action suit against the company for unemployment, lost vacation time, dangerous work conditions due to the severity of the crashes, etc. The company went bankrupt from the lawsuits and losses in production/machine repairs. The guy who took my credit was obviously fired and had an article in the paper about him sabotaging the company's production. He obviously told them I was responsible for the crashes, but the company found out that the code to my password program was his name. They believed he did this out of spite, cause he was refused a raise the previous year and his threats to them after his last evaluation. Sucks to suck, lol. Edit to all in the comments worried about the innocent workers. They were given 2 months severance pay on top of being able to collect unemployment for 16 weeks. The severance pay outlined by the lawsuit took into account all the benefits the employees had before getting laid off. I do feel guilty that there was collateral damage. However, most of the employees ended up with the equivalent of about 6 months paid vacation. So there is a happy ending. I honestly didn't think the company would continue to try and run these machines when all the ones that my supervisor took claim to programming were crashing. That was their fault/greed trying to make money instead of fixing the problems before continuing production IMO. Edit 2. It was 18 machines the first day and 15 a day the following 2 days. Second story. A family's incompetence nearly killed me. Neighbors go nuclear. A few years ago, at the age of 22, I was diagnosed with epilepsy, which came out of the blue. In my appointments with the epilepsy nurse and my neurologist, I was informed, by way of informing those who were looking for a cause for my epilepsy, that I had suffered from measles when I was around 13 months old and was not yet fully vaccinated against it. Upon returning home, I spoke with my sister and remarked that I had never heard of this before. In private, my sister decided that, as it was me who was involved, I had the right to know what she knew of the story. However, she was only 8 years old at the time and was unsure of the true extent of what had transpired. The story that she told me was as follows. Shortly after I was born, a family moved onto our street and they had a son who was around my sister's age. My sister wasn't fond of him. He was a bit pushy, but not in an unkind way. He likely just wanted to make friends and pushed his way into playing with the other children. My sister, however, has an anxiety disorder and has had it for a long time, and she didn't really appreciate his behavior, finding him quite intimidating. She knew very little about his parents and has never actually spoken to them. About a year later, I came down with the measles and was rushed to the hospital with severe complications. My sister explained that, as far as she was aware, the family was opposed to vaccinations and believed that the only way to build a natural immunity was to be infected with a virus. This was before the falsified study linking vaccines to autism. As such, when their unvaccinated son contracted the measles, the first thing that they thought of was to do the other families on the street a favor and send their infectious son out to play with the other children without warning anybody. My sister inadvertently brought the virus into the house, and we were both infected. She shrugged it off, but I wasn't so lucky. 21 years later, I would find out that this virus and the seizures that it caused at the time caused scarring in my brain that has left me with epilepsy and all of the joys that come with that. Lovely stuff. I returned from the hospital after an anticlimactic recovery, and a month later, the family disappeared. Until recently, that was all that I knew of the situation. My parents were understandably traumatized by the whole thing, and they didn't like to talk about it, so I dropped it into conversation with an elderly neighbor, who was not in any way affiliated with what happened at the time. I was informed that, while I was in the hospital, my grandmother, who has passed away, had confronted the family over what they had done during a time when it was still possible that I might have died. Their response had made my grandmother livid, and she had gone around telling everyone what they had said, which was essentially something to the effect of, "You should be thanking us. She'll be much safer now that she's had it. She'll have a more natural immunity now." To my neighbor's knowledge, nobody liked that, and for good reason. On top of that, parents didn't feel safe with them around, and there were other infants on the street who were my age or younger. People hurled abuse at them, he recalled, and they ended up leaving to stay with relatives before the house could even be sold. It was only recently that the extent of the abuse was relayed to me by another neighbor, who may or may not have taken part in it all. Their tires were slashed multiple times, almost as soon as they were replaced. Their car was keyed. When people weren't hurtling abuse at them in the street, the worst of all being my grandmother, who had a razor sharp wit, always being able to come up with something new and unique, they wrote handwritten letters calling them every obscene name under the sun and reminding them that they could be responsible for my death, posting them through their mailbox and sticking them to their windows and doors. The resident baseball boy, with the blessing of everybody present, tore their litter box off their wall and smashed it in with a baseball bat. One of the residents on the street had a pair of cats, and when they brought any little presents home, she would scoop up the unfortunate prey with a shovel and leave them on their doorstep. This evolved to include the waste of the cats too, and another neighbor who had a dog decided to do the same with his dog's droppings. This would be done primarily when they were out of the house, and this was being done in the heat of summer, so you can only imagine the smell in the cloud of flies that would be wafting around their porch when they returned hours later. The owner of the dog even went as far as to smear the droppings all over their door handle and as much of their front window as he could, though people found this just a wee bit disgusting, so he stopped. While the abuse and letters kept up, people very quickly stopped leaving droppings and such on their porch or sticking the letters to their windows because, unfortunately, their young lad, who was about 7 to 8, got caught in the crossfire. Some of the older children caught onto the fact that their parents didn't like his family and began to bully him without really ever knowing why his family was hated so much, and this ended up reaching him at school. To their credit, they realized that he likely didn't understand what was going on, and it wasn't his fault, so they dialed it back a bit and kept the abuse to where only the parents could see. This family was so distressed that they took their son and ran to the sibling of one of the parents after the sibling of the other told them quite frankly that they didn't want their unvaccinated son around their children. The house was sold in their absence. I wondered aloud why the police weren't called, because some of the perpetrators were very obvious, at which point I was informed that these people had an inherent distrust of any and all authority figures and held the belief that the system was against them, they were being oppressed, and that the police would sweep it all under the rug, so they just left instead of exposing their son to the biased police, which is really baffling to me. Because in my country, their community is a majority, and they'd be more likely to receive support. So, the moral of the story is to vaccinate your children, folks.